One night, I drove across the city in a violent rainstorm wearing my reading glasses. Beyond the rivulets of rain, the sweep of the windscreen wiper, everything was a blur. I was fast approaching 50 and on my own again. In Search of Lost Time, Marcel Proust wrote, "When all seems lost, when we have knocked at every door and they have opened upon nothing, until at last we stumble unconsciously against the only one through which we might enter the kingdom." Now, I took this to mean that one day I would walk into a room and there would be the one, which is pretty much what my friend Andrea Porter said at the time. It's just that it's far more impressive to quote Proust than your friend Andrea. And when he was a young boy, the singer, Reckless Eric's mama, told him, "There is only one girl in the world for you, and she probably lives in Tahiti." Eric chose to search the whole wide world to find out where they hide her. In Camera Lucida, one of the pictures is not by a photographer, but a scientist. For 50 years, Harold D. Edgerton photographed drops of milk to a millionth of a second in the hope of perfection. Just a few days after Andrea spoke to me, a saucy seaside laugh broke through the hubbub of a Norfolk bar. I looked up, and there was Helen Ivory. A few weeks later, I was telling anyone who would listen that I was going to marry Helen Ivory. We celebrated her birthday in a Paris restaurant, where an old French lady sent the waiter over to tell us that Helen was beautiful. At that moment, my life seemed like a movie. All its catastrophes, just plot devices, so that for this scene, the score could take flight and the credits roll for Happy Ever After. Shortly after Roland Barthes' death, they discovered an unfinished manuscript in his Paris apartment entitled "One Always Fails to Speak of the Things One Loves." In our first year together, Helen wrote a whole book of love poems about me, or a lovelier version of me, if you could possibly imagine such a thing. When people who'd read the book first met me, you could tell they were disappointed. I mean, they were too polite to say anything, but I could see it in their eyes. What, this guy? And I failed, if not to speak, to write down words that would do justice to the wonder that is Helen Ivory. Nothing for 12 years. Then one time, Harold D. Edgerton fired his flash gun. The moon falls from its starry dynamo into the fifth of seven oceans, the ocean of milk. In the piercing of meniscus, there is a white coronet. For a millionth of a second, the still center of life. Then there is only the before and the after, the ripples on the surface, sound waves of laughter. The Ferris wheel lifts us high above Paris. The lights of the waltzers spin brightly below. Twelve years later, in the happy ever after of internet shopping, I clicked buy it now and declared that I had won Valentine's Day. Helen suggested that you don't win Valentine's Day, and Facebook agreed with her. But then came Valentine's Day, and a piece of red plastic, a personalized 3D Viewmaster, won Valentine's Day. We click through our carefully chosen moments, our punctums and tiny jubilations. We still seem brand new to us, as if everything we've done is in the now, that we haven't got around to having a past yet. So it was unexpected to see a different Helen and Martin hovering in front of our eyes in shonky 3D, like a pair of goofy teenagers stumbling from the small wrecks of their lives. And how lovely it was to know that they were going to carry each other further than they might have ever hoped or imagined. In a recent attempt to extend Amy's visit routine, I took her to the local swimming pool and I coaxed her down the steps into the shallow end, which I thought was quite warm. Amy very loudly disagreed. Cold, Martin, stupid Martin, cold, Martin, and swimming pools are very echoey places. And now she had everybody's attention. She leapt on my back and shouted even louder. She'll get used to it and settle down, I thought, and carried on further into the pool. Pretty quickly, it started to look as if I was attempting to drown my own daughter in full public view. She shouted even louder. I surrendered and we headed back to the changing rooms and were home 15 minutes after that. A catastrophe by anybody's standards. Amy burst through the front door. Helen, Helen, Amy swimming, Helen, Amy swimming. Well done, Amy, good girl, Amy, Amy swimming. It was the greatest triumph there I'd ever been. And one she reminds me of every time we drive past the swimming pool. Nevertheless, we returned to our usual routine of bowling and cinema for future visits. And this is the score sheet from one of our bowling matches. Amy's fireman, Sam. I'm Dog. She decides on our names when we get there. And I had been Elvis from Fireman Sam for quite a while, but then she changed it to Dog. I mean, it does seem like a demotion, doesn't it? But anyway, the point is that Dog, me, won by close to 100 points. Now, when we got home, who do you think Amy told Helen had won? Yeah, Amy's never lost a game of anything in her life. I mean, there was a DJ at a family party who didn't understand that this was how life worked for Amy. And he eliminated her from a game of sleeping lions just for walking about. It was an outrage. She snatched the prize from under his nose, stormed back to our table, and sat there with a look of such fury it dared anyone to try and come and take it off her. Of course, nobody did. Everybody just laughed, apart from the children in the game. So she never has lost a game of anything in her life. And as far as she knows, she's immortal. I'm 61 now. And I find myself looking back from time to time. And I read this in one of those Bukowski books. I've been treated better than I should have been. Not by life in general, nor by the machinery of things, but by women. Dawn and I get together still once in a while, and she had me photograph her recent second wedding. And though we lack Amy's capacity to convert catastrophe into triumph quite so convincingly. We're careful and kind to each other. We're good people. A doctor once told us that. And we're pleased for each other's weaknesses. And went through some things together that would break your heart. Well, we keep those in a box with that photograph. And instead, when we're together, we have a bit of a laugh. And we laugh longest and hardest of all at the very idea of us. The us of that curbside embrace that I tried for so many years to rewind to. And it would be easy to look on those as wasted years now. Only the thing that we did during that time was to raise the kids. And if we'd had the nerve, we would have lost that. And of course, Amy wasn't a catastrophe at all, but a brilliant gift and someone who always steals the show. Sean, the lad who accompanied me on that road trip, knows that better than anyone. She's done it his whole life, and he's never once complained. He taught me that, and not to be a wanker. And what would life be anyway without the occasional catastrophe, without the odd shift in the machinery, without the good doctor's wheel doing its little dance once in a while? Even those perfect families. You know the ones, everyone comfortable in their own skins and each other's company. They'll have a box of sadnesses too. Everybody does. A life without catastrophe is unimaginable. What would we measure ourselves by? I'm not saying all catastrophes can be got over or kept in a box. Sometimes there'll be irreparable damage. And there's always going to be another catastrophe. You all know that, right? I mean, I'm holding out for the big one now. You know, death. Specifically mine, because I don't know how I would cope with any of the other catastrophes I imagine. Amy forgetting who I am. I'd never get over that. And the memory of my mother is an elusive sensory one that I struggle to see in those photographs that have been memento mori for over 50 years now. Roland Barthes grew up and got to know his mother as an adult. My mother and I never got beyond the narrow confines of a one-way dependency. I never knew her as an adult, and I thought this to be an irretrievable loss. But then, a couple of years ago, I was sitting on the floor in a small front room at a party where the 1950s were back in fashion. Helen and some of our friends dressed like my parents' generation, but with a bit more style. And suddenly I had the sense that I was surrounded by my aunts and uncles at a New Year's party I'd been allowed to stay up for, and to be the dark-haired first footer bringing good luck that's a piece of coal through the back door at midnight. And I'd completely forgotten that this had happened, that I had seen my past my bedtime mother laughing and enjoying herself with a drink in her hand. And as the evening wore on, I drifted between now and then and was overwhelmed with emotion. It was a kind of heaven. Each new guest slips from fog and through the door like a softly lit movie star and casts adrift the new-built houses opposite, the call centres, the inner ring roads' constant hum. And this little room is warm and bright with party dresses and men with quips in baggy suits, and in the bedroom up above where all the faux fur coats are chucked, the radio's clock flips back and back, and above the roof, above the fog, stars are streaks across the sky, and above all that, beehives glow like standard lamps, and Louis Prima swings and jokes are spilt, and someone shouts, "Fetch me a blousy woman now," and his wife throws a scarf about his neck, kisses him loose upon the mouth, and from our mouths. If you knew Susie like I know Susie, oh, 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 what a girl. And in the yard, fog is smoke and smoke is breath and cigarettes are shooting stars. And through the misted windows blur, is that my mother's gap-toothed grin? My aunts and uncles counting down? And is this me at the back door, a lump of coal ripped in my fist? Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Cheers.